Mike Florio from Football Night in America, NBCSN, here to recap the carnage. All right, recap so far. What's happened here, Mike?
Well, you know, a lot's happened already. The Jets have gotten rid of Rex Ryan, their head coach, John Idzik, their GM. The Bears have dumped Mark Trestman, their head coach, and Phil Emery, their GM. And the Falcons have gotten rid of Mike Smith, 7-year head coach, 5 straight winning seasons. That team had never had back-to-back winning seasons in its entire history. Smith is gone. It looks like GM Thomas Dimitroff stays, and we already knew about the Raiders and 49ers vacancies. So that's 5 so far. And who knows what's next? There's always a surprise. There's always one that we're not really thinking of. It could happen this week. It could happen this month. It could be a coach of a playoff team that makes a quick exit. But the ones that have happened so far were precisely the ones we expected, and now we wait for the unexpected.
Okay. You're hinting at something there with the playoff teams. Is there a coach, if he doesn't perform up to the standards of what we've come to expect out of this team, he could be on the hot seat?
Well, I tell you, one I'm keeping an eye on is Denver, just because if they fail to make it past the divisional round this year, they've got the number 2 seed in the AFC. If they would lose at home that first weekend they play after the bye, somebody's got to be responsible for the failure of this team to live up to its potential, especially after the team went all in following the Super Bowl loss last year to the Seahawks. They beefed up the defense. Peyton Manning doesn't have much time left, and they'll be 0-3 in their effort to win a Super Bowl with Peyton Manning. You have to figure somebody's going to be responsible for that. Now, will it be a coordinator? Will it be the head coach? It won't be the GM, because the GM runs the football operation too and is essentially the de facto owner at this point in John Elway. You'd have to wonder whether or not John Fox would be in trouble.
Okay, you look at these openings here, and normally you have openings on bad teams. You've got some openings here on some good teams with quality quarterback play here. Rank the openings here, and are there any names that are going to be pouncing on this, or do you see this as assistants maybe being promoted?
Well, I think that the Falcons' job is the most attractive when you consider that they've got a franchise quarterback in Matt Ryan. Now, I know he has his faults, and he's failed to perform when the spotlight is the brightest, but how many of these jobs ever have a quarterback that you can look at and say, oh yeah, I can work with that guy? And wouldn't Rex Ryan make a ton of sense for a team like Atlanta or even Chicago if you're going to keep Jay Cutler? You bring in somebody who can really beef up the defense, and that's what Atlanta needs desperately. You get a good offensive system in place, and that was Rex Ryan's Achilles heel in New York, but wouldn't it make sense? I mean, he was a finalist the last time around, and I know he's kind of the exact opposite of Mike Smith, but you know, that's one trend that seems to hold true every year, Dan.
Yep.
Teams hire the exact opposite of the guy that they just had, and Rex Ryan is pretty much the exact opposite of Mike Smith.
Here's the problem. This is what I was told about the Atlanta situation, is Arthur Blank loved Mike Smith's personality. He, they never butted heads. He was a nice man. He wanted him to succeed, and that Rex Ryan would be the opposite of that, and that might be a reason why. Now, I was told 6 weeks ago, maybe 2 months ago, that's where Rex could end up, and that he has a relationship with Arthur Blank. I just don't know if Arthur brings in somebody who is willing to question him, butt heads, be out there in front of the media. Just a different attitude there.
Yeah, but sometimes these owners get to an age where they say, you know what, I don't know how many more of these chances I've got left, and if I want to have that silver trophy in my hands. And the Falcons have had a couple of seasons where it looked like they had a chance to make a serious run at it. They were the number 1 seed in 2010, got blown out at home by the Packers, number 1 seed in 2012. They blew some big leads at home and eventually lost to the 49ers in the NFC title game. They've been close. Maybe Arthur Blank deals with somebody that doesn't naturally mesh with his personality because he thinks that's a guy that can help me win what I want.
It's Mike Florio from ProFootballTalk.com. You can see him Monday through Friday at 5:30 Eastern on NBCSN. Tell me what happened here with Johnny Manziel throwing a party, and all of a sudden he doesn't show up for treatment. Josh Gordon is going to cost him unrestricted free agency here. What the hell is going on here?
Well, why do we expect the guy to start his New Year's resolution before January 1?
Who said
next year I'm
going to
take it seriously?
Oh, okay.
Right? Okay. Well, it's the whole thing's a mess. And what did the Browns expect? And I'm surprised a little bit that Jimmy Haslam, the owner of that team, isn't firing somebody after they went from 7-4 to 7-9. And with these distractions, somebody was responsible for bringing these guys in. Now, Josh Gordon was already there before Haslam bought the team, and of course Haslam had his finger in the pot too, which it's kind of hard to blame the general manager, the head coach, for Johnny Manziel when the owner's fingerprints were all over the Manziel decision. But it looks like they're not going to tolerate this kind of stuff going forward. It's easy to say that now, but then the question becomes, how do we find more talented players? How do we find a better quarterback? Are we going to look for a better quarterback? Are we going to try to get the most out of Manziel? And who knows? It's Cleveland, and it's unfortunate for the fans of that team because they've dealt with a lot of garbage over the years, and I don't know that we can look at it and say that there's any reason to believe it's going to change dramatically next season.
Yeah, you can't sit there and go, boy, man, we're surprised Johnny Manziel was partying with Josh Gordon. The Ndamukong Suh play with Aaron Rodgers. What do you think happens here?
Well, they're going to look at it today. And just a week ago, it was Dominic Raiola who was suspended for a game. But his was a stomp. This was a subtle kind of, oh, did I do that kind of thing? And, it reminded me of that foot to the groin of Matt Schaub on Thanksgiving a couple of years ago, where there's a subtlety to it. There's a nuance to it, where you get the foot in the vicinity and you just give it that push. You don't do it blatantly, but you still do it. And I think and I agree with Coach Dungy. I heard him on last hour, and we were talking about this last night. At first you look at it and say, oh, that's just accidental. And then you look at it and say, well, wait a minute. He knows what he's doing there. He puts that second foot right onto the leg, steps down, lifts the other leg off the ground, and gives that same kind of push that he gave when he had his foot in Matt Schaub's groin. And the question is, will the NFL look through whatever excuse is given and say, no, we know what we see. We know your history. It's an extensive history. And we don't believe there's any place for this kind of stuff in our game, even if it means suspending a marquee player for a playoff game. I think it would take a lot to do it. And frankly, I think they stopped short last time with Raiola. I think he deserved at least two games for what he did. They gave him one game. They didn't suspend him for the playoff game. It's going to take a lot to suspend Sue for the playoff game. But if they do, it sends an unmistakable message about the league's attitude toward player safety.
Does the NFL look at tanking? I know this is a hot topic with the NBA, but if this were the NBA with what happened with Tampa yesterday, should the league have a problem with what they saw yesterday?
They should, Dan. And we've talked about this before, because coaches and players they'll never tank. Players especially, we're never going to tank. No, well, you take those players off the field and you put the other players in who aren't as good. That's how you tank. Mm. And in this case, you got a head coach who isn't worried about losing his job. He's just getting started. You've got an organization that benefits tremendously from having the first overall pick, whether they use it or trade it. It's so much better to have the number one pick than the number two pick. And it's obvious here, Mike Evans, star rookie receiver, gone at halftime. Lavonte David, one of the best young linebackers in the NFL, gone at halftime. It just was a little too obvious here, and I don't know what the NFL can do about it unless people admit to it. And people, I don't know why people react negatively to the idea of a draft lottery, but that does minimize the temptation to tank. If the Buccaneers had not known yesterday that we definitely are going to have the top pick if we do this, then maybe they wouldn't have done it.
Thank you, Mike. I know you're short on sleep. Thanks for joining us.
All right, see you, pal.
All right, Mike Florio, Pro Football Talk. You can see him tonight on NBCSN.